shades, no problem.
Did you?
Yeah, I loved that. I walked out of Home Depot not having to pay a dime.
Dr. Doherty, are you ready?
Are you impressed?
You sure?
All right. Boy, that does not happen.
Hey, Mario. Hello, welcome.
Yeah, are they yours? Or?
Alex. Alex, it's good to see you. All right. Good evening, everybody. I'm going to call the September 26, 2016 school committee back to order at 7:30, and we are now a half an hour behind schedule. So my apologies to everyone who was here on time. Our executive session did go a bit long. I'm going to start tonight with public comment the way we usually do. Is there anyone here tonight who would like to address the committee on a topic that is not on our agenda? Seeing none. I'd like to move to the consent agenda. We have some very generous donations. We have the approval of some minutes, and we also have some field trips in the consent agenda. Dr. Doxer?
Yes, I'd like to motion that we take the football donation out of the consent agenda, please.
Very good. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor of removing that? That's unanimous. Thank you. Anything else removed from the consent agenda? No? Okay. Do I have a motion?
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented, with the exception of the Friends of Reading football.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? That's 6-0. Thank you very much. The reason I think that Dr. Doxer just removed that donation is we're very lucky to have Tom Connery here tonight to talk a little bit about this very generous donation. So if you wouldn't mind approaching and tell us a little bit about what the money is going to be used for.
Sure, thank you. So thank you to the school committee for having me here this evening. My name is Tom Connery, and I am the 7-year president of the Friends of Reading football. And we have been good stewards with our money, and this year decided as an initiative that we would concentrate on student athlete safety. And I know that perhaps that is an issue that is near and dear to your hearts. And the committee this year voted, the board of directors, to donate Guardian helmets to the football team. These are a device that sits and is fastened to the top of the helmet and helps with concussive activity so as to make the head and the side and the cheekbones and the jaw more stable. That donation was 120 helmets for the team, and the value was $5,533.25. And in addition, we purchased 3 tackle rings. Those tackle rings are made by a specialty company down in Rhode Island, and the purpose of the tackle ring is to create a device that moves across the field and provides the coaches with the ability to give instruction for tackling, and it avoids during the preseason and certainly during weekday practice the need for body-on-body contact. That donation amount was $1,585. For a total equipment donation of $7,118. So we're very pleased to do that, and we hope that the team benefits from it. Our win on Friday night perhaps was an indication of that. In addition, the Friends of Reading football once again has donated the funds for 3 coach stipends. Giuseppe Federa is a freshman coach, Andrew Mercy is a freshman coach, and James Benedictus is our videographer. That coach stipend donation is $3,940. Why do we pay a videographer? And perhaps this is helpful for you to know. The school last year included in its budget the use of the Huddle program. Mm-hmm. And Huddle is a very specific program used for filming and video games, and our eye on the camera focuses very much on the play, not on the fans or the broader field, and we feed that down in through Huddle, and that's what the coaches use to play back for game understanding. We get film from other teams a week before each game, so we are able to study and understand our play system, and so the videographer is a very helpful part of what we do with Huddle, and we're very thankful that the school supports us in that regard. So, thank you very much for having me here this evening. And on behalf of the Friends of Reading Football, we're pleased to support the football team.
Well, we are so grateful for your generous donation. I have a question about the equipment.
Yes.
Is that those kind of helmets typically being used, or is this kind of the cutting edge?
Cutting edge.
That's great.
Just one of a few in the state that are doing it.
It's fantastic.
In fact, so much so that the MIAA has not even endorsed them yet for use during regular games. So you'll see just a few teams using them during their practices.
Oh. That was actually going to be Mike. You used them. I saw them in use in the scrimmage, but not in the game.
Not in the game.
Okay.
Not MIAA.
That's got a meter on the back or something that measures the impact.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mrs.
Webb. It's a very generous donation. I just want to also thank you, Mr. Connery, for your long dedication serving us 7 years as the president. That's a tremendous, tremendous amount of resource and sacrifice and commitment. And just having that sort of consistency of leadership and involvement really, you know, gets efficiencies that that enable the group to do even more amazing things for the team and the district. So appreciate it.
It is beneficial in terms of a continuum of business activity. Mm-hmm. It is quite frankly also necessary as an outgrowth to the school district's policy of requiring, and in this instance, some teams or some parent groups to incorporate. So this is a real business. This is a corporation that has legal responsibilities. We have a lawyer, we have a tax accountant, and all this is absolutely required when you have a corporation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much
Thanks
for being
much.
Here, and thank you for
thank
the generous
you.
Donation.
Do we have to go on now?
Yeah, we do. I think you can. That's presented.
So.
Yes.
I'd like to move to accept the donation from Reading, Friends of Reading Football, for the donation in the amount of $7,118.25 for equipment and $3,940 for coach stipends.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? 6-0.
Thanks,
Mr. Connery.
Thanks, Tom.
Oh, that was wonderful. I think we're going to go right on to reports. Is that okay?
If I may make a suggestion,
yeah.
If we want to have the student reports, and then we can always have the other reports later.
Yeah, you read my mind.
Because we have guests.
Yeah, and they've waited long enough. So Alex and Mario are student representatives. How has the first few weeks of school been?
So tomorrow, we don't actually have to be in class until 8, but we can use our teachers at 7:30 for any extra help we need. And we've also had a built-in flex ball to the day. We've been having them every Thursday since school started. And during this time, students go to their homerooms, and a lot of the seniors have been having college meetings for their guidance classes.
Yeah, a lot of schedule changes have been coming up, but recently there's been, like, the parking passes have been going out, and there's been an issue where certain people who've got them haven't had their license yet. So it's been, I don't know how they're working it out now. I just thought I'd bring it up because that's something going on.
I'm glad that you did. Maybe we can refer that to Mr. Parker? Yeah, thank you. Okay. Oh, sure.
Volley for the Cure is happening this Friday. Varsity is playing at 6 p.m. in the field house, and they're looking for people to come and support.
Great. Thank you. Thank you both. All right. We will put off reports till later in the evening. Shall we move on to Understanding Disabilities?
Yes.
Oh, wonderful. So Understanding Disabilities is a nonprofit in town that's very close to my heart. So thank you for coming out, and I apologize again for running a little late. I'm really excited to hear what you're up to this year.
Can you see over us?
Yeah.
Thank you for inviting us here tonight. My name is Karen Sarovich, and with me is Paula Tucci. I just want to point out Diana Blanc-Coster is here with us as well. We appreciate the opportunity to update you on the Understanding Disabilities program. We've had great success since we saw you last. I'd like to tell you some of what we've been doing operationally, and Paula will then tell you about our curriculum innovation that we're very excited to be teaching this year for the first time. Let's start with a brief summary of UD. Our mission is to help children see beyond people's disabilities and view other children as individuals and friends. We focus on the ways we are all the same inside. We teach 8 different workshops on a range of disabilities. The 8th one is about emotional and behavioral disorders, and we're premiering it with 5th graders this school year. We teach in grades 1st through 8th. As we know, the more times we put the concepts before children, the better they will incorporate the messages of inclusion and respect in their lives. The structure of the program, which will remain the same with the new curriculum, is providing information, using hands-on activities for deeper learning, and introducing speakers. Our speakers are a hallmark of UD. They talk about their disability and their daily life. When children relate personally, they not only hear, but experience the many ways in which we are all the same inside. Our speakers are amazing. Last year, for example, we introduced Nico Calabria to the middle schoolers. Nico is a student at Colorado College. He was born with one leg and one hip, and at 12 years old, he was the first person to climb Mount Kilimanjaro using crutches. Nico has more personal and physical accomplishments than most, yet he describes so well why we need the UD program. I'd like to show you a clip from that presentation.
Nothing too bad, but I was excluded from playing soccer when I was an elementary schooler. When I moved, the kids that were in my class didn't accept me. That changed over time. But yeah, that was one of the harder things. Was I overcoming physical challenges actually comes really easy to me, and it isn't something that I struggle with, I would say. But the social challenges of having one leg and a fitting into a room and feeling accepted is probably a bigger challenge. And I think that's true for most people with disabilities. All of us crave being accepted and being part of the group, feeling belonging and accepted. So for people with disabilities, I can be very proud.
The students really enjoyed hearing Nico. I know some of you got to come as well, and I know you.
It was wonderful.
I could just interject. I've seen Nico compete as a high school wrestler. He was an outstanding wrestler. He had his own style that he adopted. I don't think you could find someone who took his, if you want to call it a disability, but in some cases it was actually an advantage the way he wrestled. Plus he's just an outstanding young man. I mean, he was always very courteous, showed great sportsmanship, so that was a really good choice.
I actually met Nico at a wrestling meet. It was actually the state championship, and he came in 3rd.
Yeah.
But what, in addition to everything that you just mentioned, the other thing that struck me was that everyone that was competing against him either showed him great respect or didn't notice him at all. They just treated him the same as everyone else, and really that's what this was all about.
In addition to our work in the schools, we also sponsor awareness events in the community. On October 16th, we'll be painting pumpkins teal for food allergy awareness at Halloween. Everyone is welcome to register on our website, understandingdisabilities.org. We'll also be highlighting dyslexia awareness in October. April, we'll see Old South Church lighted blue as part of the worldwide Lighted Up Blue for Autism Awareness campaign. Schools last year were very impressive in their participation with this in this campaign. The staff all wore blue ribbons provided by UD, and many staff and students wore blue. They even raised money to buy autism-themed books for the school libraries. We have an extraordinary team of 200 volunteers who I'd like to thank. They help teach classes, run the organization, fundraise. Many of our volunteers turn over from year to year, and we bring in 30 or so new volunteers each year. This year is pretty special, though. We're welcoming about 60 new volunteers, each one of them desperately needed. But we also welcome a new lead teacher, Daisy Junta. Daisy has her degree in special ed from BU, and we're thrilled to have her join our team. UD operates for less than $25,000 a year. We are supported entirely by the generous Reading community. Our most important fundraiser, our Jail and Bail, took place at the Reading Street Fair. Thank you all for serving your time. You did well fundraising, but I think there are still some people waiting to be bailed out.
It's a long time in there.
What was that? You were a long time.
It was a long time in there.
Does the White House know about this? watch this segue. Listen to this segue. As we're all aware, from the federal and state emphasis on social and emotional learning, all children need to feel safe in their school environment, socially safe, in order for them to access their higher learning abilities. Reading has had social and emotional learning programs for many years, as you all know, Understanding Disabilities being one example. In fact, Understanding Disabilities has been a Reading tradition for 32 years, which means that by now it's very much a part of the fabric of our town. And looking at the clip from NICO, you can understand how it is that we're helping to generate that culture that is both positive and inclusive. But 2 years ago, Understanding Disabilities was awarded a Cummings Foundation grant to allow us to study and rewrite our curriculum to meet the needs of a changing classroom as well as society. Cummings Foundation recognized our 32 years of experience as well as passion and partnered with us to establish, what has turned out to be establishing UD as the leader in disability awareness. We didn't set out to go down that path, but so many people have heard about what we were doing and so many communities have contacted us that we're actually working with several other communities now. But that's not the reason we're here tonight. We're here to tell you that we're very excited that this year will be for Reading students rolling out our new curriculum. And so we wanted to show you what sets us apart and what changes we've made this year. But first of all, our promise far exceeds, let me turn so that I can face you as well, John. Our promise far exceeds others. Disability awareness programs typically aim to increase compassion in the student body, whereas we are taking it beyond compassion and really going to teach respect, because respect is about worth and respect is about dignity. And to us, disability is something that causes a person to do something in a different way. But what we're really emphasizing this year is that different is okay. Right? Accomplishment is accomplishment. If you're playing four corners, it doesn't matter whether you walk to the nearest corner or whether you wheel to the nearest corner. You're still playing, right? You're still in the game and you're still having fun. The second difference is that we include Everyone Matters curriculum. For Understanding Disabilities, we say that we're all the same inside. So we're all different in many ways, and many of those ways are to be celebrated. But in very important ways, we're all the same inside. Each of our lessons explicitly teaches this and builds on the lesson before it. And by the spring of your fourth grade year, when you're learning about developmental disabilities, We have an activity that hopefully will highlight how another important way that we're all the same inside. We ask each of the children to write down on a piece of paper what gift or value they bring to the world. And what we then extend that invitation to the classroom teacher, the understanding disabilities teachers and classroom assistants, but also to our guests who have developmental disabilities. And so hopefully by incorporating everyone in that simple activity, which focuses on our gift to the world, kids really do believe that and see it modeled in front of them. Seeing it modeled in front of them will help them to really understand and believe it. Our lessons, by the way, apply to any disability, certainly, and also to all differences. And we, in our lessons, do specify that, but it also leaves it open for teachers to incorporate those same concepts as they need to and as they wish in their lessons from day to day. We talk about friendship a lot in each and every lesson. And I would say that friendship themes are actually on an equal par with our disability awareness themes. What we're doing is increasing personal connection and personal interaction. We provide information about daily lives, about likes, about hopes and dreams, how every child wonders what they're going to be when they grow up, right? That's something that, everyone shares, and we like to have the kids look at that. We show that people can and want to do the same things that others do. And in fact, we show and teach about different assistive devices in that light. This is something that allows a person to do what they need to do, and in fact, to do what they want to do. We don't leave things to chance. We very specifically teach how to. We teach a child, we teach children how to get the attention of a person who is hard of hearing so that you can invite them to play baseball after school. We teach children that if there's someone with low vision in a room, that it's important to introduce themselves as they enter the room and to identify themselves as they enter the room. And maybe to even talk to them about what else is happening in the room. We teach children that it's okay to talk about disability, and we show them how to do that in a respectful way. This year we're adding a lesson on emotional and behavioral disorders, and fittingly it's happening in fifth grade, a year of great emotional change. Our approach is very general though. We don't talk about specific disorders, and we don't talk about symptoms of specific disorders. What we do talk about is emotions that we all share. We talk about behaviors, and we talk about the very normal circumstances that can cause emotions or behaviors to be outside of typical. And we mostly focus with kids on how what to do with that, that there's lots of help available, and we talk to them about the people that are available to help. This year we're introducing UD at Home, which we hope to launch soon in the year, hopefully with some fanfare. And UD at Home is an online resource that allows children to take their families online, show them what they learned in school, and take that learning further if they so choose. So we're able to do all of this, and the reason that we're successful is, well, for a lot of reasons, but three that I want to point out is that because we teach in grades 1 through 8, our programming reaches children early, and we repeat the messages often. So that repetition, especially during those early years and adolescent years, I think really helps in kids to understand. And we often hear back from kids in high school who say that they're using language from understanding disabilities class to get on with other kids, and especially in like group projects and things of that nature. So we use proven teaching methodologies. We use context and question and answer and scaffolding and social scaffolding and activities. And our multimedia tools allow the program to be accessible. We also have the ability to measure our impact, and feedback keeps the program improving and self-adjusting. But we have had the very good fortune to have many contributors in creating this state-of-the-art curriculum. We are working with medical experts, educators, child development specialists, with people with disability, as well as parents of children with disability. And many insights and ideas have come from people in this room. Thank you. Many of Reading school staff and administration is involved in the program. Our next step, in fact, is to incorporate Sarah Bird's social and emotional learning standards by grade into our curriculum. Maybe I should say that in reverse, so that we support her standards. And so we appreciate your help, everyone here, and your support. And we feel that it's our privilege to be doing this work. It's our privilege to be serving on the team with you in increasing the positive attitude of our school culture. And we thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I'd say it's our privilege. Our kids are lucky. Most communities, as you said, I am ecstatic to hear that you are expanding this and other communities are interesting, because I think we take it for granted in Reading that our kids have access to this every single year. We're very lucky. So thank you.
So I just want to raise up that maybe folks who have been in the community just for the last few years sort of see how UD is part of the fabric. But over, I can't believe, did you say 32?
No, I have not been volunteering that.
So, but over at least the last, I'm going to say 22 or 23 years that I am aware, there were times where it wasn't on such good footing. And it took a lot of people, and you've probably been involved from the beginning, to make sure that it stayed, that we got it going, that, you know, there were times when there weren't enough resources from the school district to fund it, and you guys had to go back out and sort of like rethink, how do we do this? And we had to reaffirm, yes, we have a commitment, we just don't have a lot of resources, so, you know, how do we do this? So I just want to say, I know Paul, you personally, and you know, some of the people that sort of went before you, and the people that are now carrying it, it wasn't always on such a sure footing. It wasn't something that was like to be taken for granted for. Basically, we've come to expect this. This is a luxury that we have in our community. So I just want to thank you for that and recognize that the journey wasn't always that easy. And appreciate, I'm totally impressed, 60 new volunteers.
And part of it, the way that we're doing that is by talking more with parents, educating parents more about the fact that we do exist and what the program does. And it speaks for itself, this program.
Right.
It really does. And there's a lot of passion, I think, represented here. So it's our pleasure to continue the program.
Thank you.
Dr. Doxer?
I just quickly wanted to say that it's been my honor through the years, both as a volunteer and as the School Notes columnist, for years and years, to learn about the impact that UD has had on our students and on our families, to trickle down, you know, when they go back and they talk to their families and the parents that are volunteering and are able to meet the speakers, that it's really had an impact on each level, each grade level, from elementary to middle to high school. And it's been great listening to people extol the virtues of this program and seeing the kids that behave in different ways because of it. Thank you.
We hear from a lot of people beyond high school as well.
Yes.
Who tell us that this program has influenced their life in some way. Perhaps it's their career or just how they approach other people. Very rewarding.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Mrs. Wilson, you're going to talk to us a little bit about, it's a good time of year. School year just sort of began. We're getting resettled.
just an overview, and then at some reports as we move through, I'll provide more data as we get deeper into the school year on some of our enrollment numbers, our program numbers, but this is more just an overview and some refresher on things related to special education. So, and I'm gonna be relatively quick. I put a lot of information in the PowerPoint, but to keep us on schedule, there's information about the programs in here that I have reviewed with the CPAC, but I'll touch on it, but it's in there in writing so you can take a look and read that information rather than me speaking to that.
Thank you.
So as you know, the Individuals with Disabilities Act is what governs what we're doing related to special education here in Reading. It's federal law, and our obligations to that is to provide a free, appropriate public education in the least restrictive environment. So this is a perfect segue from UD talking about inclusion and opportunities for our students with disabilities to be part of the fabric of our schools, and this comes directly from the federal law. And the law also is there to protect the rights of students and parents, so that guides how we interact with families, how we interact with students, and what protections they have. Our regular education teachers play a big role in special education. And I wanted to bring that up because sometimes I think we forget that it's not just our special educators, our related service personnel, myself, that our classroom teachers play a huge part in making our classrooms accessible and ensuring that all students access that rich curriculum that we have. And that's an important piece of working with students with disabilities. So we can't leave them out of the mixture when we think about this. So in relation to the IEP process, I just wanted to do a refresher and walk people through that when we have a student who's identified with a disability, we have a process that we have to follow in order to determine eligibility. And that determination is made by each child's individual IEP team, which is made up of a teacher, their parents, sometimes the student, depending on their age, and other educational professionals who may be part of that team. And that team completes an eligibility determination to see if the student is eligible. And if they are eligible, they develop an IEP. And then based on what the team determines around the IEP, they determine the placement for that student. So the first step in that process is evaluation. So parents can request an evaluation from the school district, or we may, as a district, as part of our child find obligation, we have an obligation to identify students with disabilities. We may find a student that we suspect has a disability and refer them. Last year, in the April presentation, I went through the numbers of referrals we received from our in-house teams, our SST teams. Those are our building-based teams that do the child find component, and I'll provide updated data for you on that as well. Our goal is to make sure that our teams are finding, are accurate, that we're finding those students who do have disabilities, and I think our data at the end of the year showed we were doing a relatively good job across the district. The other piece, let me go back to the evaluation, I just want to point out is that when we do an evaluation of a student, I put in here, it can take from anywhere from 8 to 36 hours of staff time per child. That's why it's really important that our teams are identifying and being more accurate in the referral process. It's a lot of time spent on that process, and we truly want to be using that for the students who require that type of service. So then the team process, I wanted to put this in because I think sometimes people think I know everything that happens at every team, and that's really not my role as the Director of Student Services. It's really the individual teams that include the team chair, the teachers, the parents, the evaluators. They're the ones doing the work on the student. They know the students best. They're the experts on that student. And they're looking for a presence of a disability. So first the teams have to identify, is there a disability based on the information presented? And then does the disability impact the student's ability to access and make progress in the curriculum? Is the lack of progress a result of the disability? And then do they require special education services? So there's a number of questions that drive that process that are based on the federal law. They have nothing to do with what specific to Reading Public Schools. Those are pieces, those are questions we need to ask anytime we do an eligibility determination. What you'll see here, and I always like to show this because again, we don't drive what disability categories there are. The state and federal regulations drive the categories that we have for identifying students with disabilities in an educational setting. There are many other disabilities that are outside of our setting, but in an educational setting, these are the categories that our IEP teams are charged with looking at and determining. We also have to look at effective progress. This is always a difficult conversation for our teams, is how do you determine whether a student is making effective progress? The Department of Education gives us some guidance, but it also leaves it gray and allows teams to interpret. Our goal is that students have access to the life of our school. So some students make good academic progress, but they struggle with the social connections or with their social emotional behavioral needs. So they may require special education services. So when we're looking at effective progress, it's not just about are they passed, is it PARC, is it their academic, are they getting all A's and B's on their report cards? We're looking at them as accessing the life of our school. What does that mean for them, and are they making effective progress in that category? The other piece is the need for specialized instruction. So a student may have a disability, but they may not need specialized instruction. They may not need to be taught in a different way. They may need some accommodations, some changes made to the environment that can be done without specialized instruction. So we are really looking at, does this student require something different? Do they need to be taught in a different way? Do they need a specific methodology? Or do they need speech and language services, occupational therapy, physical therapy, in order to access the curriculum? So it has to be tied into that access to the curriculum. Once all of those things are determined, then the team goes about developing the IEP, which is our contract with the family, that these are the services that we are recommending for the student in order for them to make progress in the curriculum, and that we have an obligation to provide. There are accommodations put in there, there are services, and there are goals for each student. And it is individualized, so I think that's really important, that it's not a cut and paste, that if you have a certain disability, then this is what you get. We really focus on making sure those are individualized plans. The other piece I wanted to highlight was the role of the building principal. They play a very important role in the special education process. We collaborate together on special education, but they are the one in the building that is responsible for ensuring sort of the day-to-day operation. They work with me in identifying staff, but they're the ones who do the interviewing, the hiring. We collaborate, we identify what the needs are for staffing, but they hire those individuals or make the recommendations for hire. The superintendent does the hiring. They do the supervision and evaluation. We may work together. If there is a question about a particular staff member, that I may come in and do an observation, but the building principal is the primary person on that. The building principal also has to ensure that we have an SST process, a student referral process, as part of that child find obligation. And they also have an obligation to educate their staff on the DCAP, the District Curriculum Accommodation Plan. So that's a big role that our building principals play. They also are responsible for when we have students who, for a temporary period of time, can't be in school, they need to be in the home or the hospital, and helping coordinate educational services for those students. So I put up there the regulation that it refers to that, but I think that it's also just an understanding that I don't oversee all the special educators or related service. I work very closely with the principals on doing that, and I'm a support to them, but they do a lot of that work at the building level. So as I mentioned, I did put in updated information on all of our special education programs. I did want to highlight the RISE preschool because I think it's just important to note our obligation that we need to provide services when a student hits their third birthday. This is the population of students that is the most unpredictable for us. As we saw last year, we needed to add a preschool teacher in after April vacation because our numbers had increased greatly. We often can't predict that. We do work closely with early intervention, but you just never know what that population will be and what the needs of those students will be. So it's just something to keep in mind that it's just something we don't always have a good handle on that group. And every year I put in here, we do have a waiting list for typical peers who want to participate in that program. And unfortunately, due to space, we just don't have the room to add more programs. So you'll see, I went through each of the different programs. The Learning Center is a way we provide support in every building in the district, and then you'll see each of the programs, and I'm just gonna skip through those, but we can definitely spend more time if there are questions. I tried to give you a crosswalk, so what it shows you is the old name, the new name, you have a description, methodology, and the locations of each of the programs. And hopefully, as our website evolves, this information will be on there. The different programs. As I said, this was directly out of our presentation to the CPAC that I gave the end of last year. So I wanted to also touch on some of the staffing challenges that we've had this year. So we have team chair vacancies, which is a huge hole. Our team chairs are administrators who oversee the IEP process in each of the buildings. We currently have one vacancy at the high school because our team chair that we did have at the high school wanted to go back to teaching, which I totally respect and honor, and she did a great job for us as a team chair, but we do have a vacancy there and haven't been able to find someone, but we're hoping that we potentially have a candidate that might be able to start sometime soon, so that will be great. And then we also have an elementary vacancy that includes our out-of-district students. So that has been a little bit of a challenge. We are doing some interviews on Thursday. Hopefully we'll be able to identify a candidate for that. We do have some staff who are assisting us in the interim as we search for more permanent candidates for that position. But as you can imagine, those positions are very critical for communication with parents and processing the paperwork and just ensuring good communication from the building level. So that has been a challenge for us. We have had a speech and language vacancy at Barrows. We've been contracting with a staffing agency to provide the services, but my understanding is that we have a person who has been hired.
Yes.
So we are excited about a new speech and language pathologist joining us at Barrows. We have a special education teacher of reading that is vacant at Reading Memorial High School. This has been a long-standing position that we've really struggled to fill. We have done a lot of outreach with very little success. We've reached out to a staffing agency. We've reached out to Commonwealth Learning, that is a tutoring service that provides this. We've reached out to a couple other places that provide tutors for teachers who are Wilson or Orton-Gillingham certified, and no one seems to have a person that would be available to do this. So we're kind of putting together a plan with some contracted service, with some in-district staff members who are willing to provide some things before school starts for them, our elementary teachers who will be willing to come over to the high school early in the morning. So we're putting together individual schedules for specific students to meet their IEP needs. And there will be some compensatory services we'll need to offer to those families for some of the services we've missed. But that has been one of our biggest challenges, I will say, in finding someone who is qualified, who is both special ed licensed and has either Wilson or Orton-Gillingham certification, not training. Lots of people have gone to training. Mm-hmm. Not many people reach the certification point. We are sending three of our staff this week. Thursday, yeah. Friday. They are attending the initial Wilson training. So three of our special ed teachers at the high school will go to the initial Wilson training, which then will make them eligible to participate in the next part to become certified. It is a year-long program to receive certification because you do a practicum where you're observed. So out of that group, I know there was one person who was interested in moving forward. So that next year we won't be in this position. We have also reached out to another company called LTR, who's gonna come on site and do a training for our high school and middle school staff on a program that's also through Wilson called Just Words, which we hope will just give us another tool in our toolbox to support students who are having challenges in reading. So we're trying to address it from all different fronts. We're also sending some of our staff, and I'll talk about this a little more, to Lyndon Rubel, training, which is another reading program. So we're sending a high school staff person through that as well. So it's just building those capacities. We do have also some paraprofessional vacancies in building, so we're still working to fill those. And one of the challenges that we have this year is home services. So for some of our students, they require services in the home. And we had done this previously with some of our teaching staff, and they've made the decision they don't want to do that anymore. So we are working to identify personnel who can provide those home services. The goal of that is to carry over some of the goals the students are working on in school, and to help the student generalize them in other environments and help families do some family training. So we are using the staffing agency where we've posted that position and have some applicants in district, but it has been a little more of a challenge to find staff who have the qualifications we're looking for and would be a match for the individual students.
I think we had a question.
Yeah, sure.
With the team chair vacant, who's doing that now, the building principal or?
Well, at the high school, we have a team chair. So he's kind of assuming the entire high school. So there are two team chairs.
Oh, there's two.
There's two at the high school.
Yeah. And then at the elementary level, we've contracted with someone at Joshua Eaton to come in.
And Carolyn's been doing the out of districts
right
now.
Okay.
So.
And how close is that to getting filled?
We're hoping soon, but you know, it is a challenge. And the out of district is definitely a unique set of credentials that you're looking in a person to have some familiarity with managing those type of cases and understanding the intricacies of that role, because it's not just a team chair in a building. It does require some additional skill sets.
These are not easy positions to fill, even in regular circumstances when you have some lead time. It's more difficult when you're already starting your school year.
And obviously, I know it's difficult to try to find the best qualified person. Is there any financial implication here? If we had more money to spend, would we find more qualified individuals?
Special education positions in general are difficult to find. The pool is not very deep. With the team chairs, I would say, it may be a more of a funding issue. With the other positions, I think it has to do with the depth of the pool, because there just isn't a lot of prospective applicants out there. The other challenge at this point, once the school year has started, is if they are coming from another school district, now you're waiting a month to two, because they have contractual obligations to their district, so I have to bargain with the other district to try to get the person here quicker, and
you also, you know, you wonder who's applying, so you know there's a different type of vetting process at this time of the year,
right,
that you're looking at,
right.
Who is interested in leaving their district at
right.
this point in the school year, and you know you really want to check references, you want to not make a hasty decision because we have a vacancy and not find the right match. I mean, I think we've done a nice job identifying, in particular for the team chairs, some really strong candidates, and we want to continue identifying those right matches for our district.
So were most of these vacancies sort of vacancies that we sort of came into the start of the school year, you know, a little bit behind on filling, or are they as a result of needs and that we were maybe not aware of? I mean, is it a work, you know, an increase in the caseload? And I'm particularly about the home service.
The home services were a change in providers that kind of came to light throughout the summer, how great the needs were. There were some staff members providing this service, and they made the decision sort of midsummer that this wasn't something they were going to continue during the school year. And then as I started digging deeper, more information came to light about how many hours we need and the type of credentials we need for this position. Mm-hmm. So that was an unexpected position. The team chair position, the high school position, had been posted all since the spring, I believe. We had it posted, and we really couldn't find any good candidates over the summer. The elementary position was a relatively...
That just happened, yeah.
Vacancy. The speech and language at Barrows was posted. They had done a lot of interviewing for that over the summer, and again, it was just finding the right match. And then the reading teacher has been an ongoing struggle for us.
The speech and language, just to go in a little bit more detail, we did have a person hired, but then the person backed out.
To go to another district?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Probably not for less money. Can I,
yes, yes.
So on the high school reading, I was reading that as reading,
yeah,
but it's reading. So is that area that, because that's a very, also a very difficult sort of specialty area at the high school level?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
What about the local, it seems like so many young people that I talk to who are going for teaching, I mean, we're not gonna hire a college student, I get that, but like special ed, going into special ed, because, I mean, which was is probably a good choice if you're starting college because there's clearly a demand, but I'm just wondering if any of the relationships that we have, you know, with some of the colleges where we have some student teachers, mm-hmm. whether that's something that, are we able to do that and nurture that or make those connections for special ed as
we
well?
We reached out to Endicott to see, again, because we need this Wilson certification, mm-hmm. or Orton-Gillingham certification, a lot of times the student teacher wouldn't have that.
Oh.
But I did speak with them because they do have a program that we're exploring where they place a like a fellow in your district, and so it is like a fellowship program, and they have reading specialists and special educators who participate in that program. So they said they'd circle back with us in January to see if we were still interested. So,
mm-hmm.
But we've reached out to Endicott. We reached out to
Gordon. Did we still? We had some relationships with Gordon previously.
Reached out to Gordon, but
Salem State.
And I've reached out to all the area special ed directors, so in our collaborative, and no one's really had any leads, or if they have had a lead,
they're keeping it to
themselves. One response was good luck, which is always very encouraging as you're seeking that out. So we've tried to really branch out and not just limit it to, you know, oh, we're just going to repost. We've really tried to bring it up. I brought it up at my meeting at SEEM Collaborative just to see if anyone had any potential leads. And you know, unfortunately, it's just a challenging role, and I think some of it is being the high school level,
mm-hmm.
And then having that certification on top of it. So I think our best option is to grow the capacity in-house so we can have some more stability.
Especially if you have that short-term plan. If
yes.
if you see this is how we can get through this year, but there's a plan for stability in the future.
Yes, which is what we need.
I have a question. I just wanted to clarify that other district
Yes, currently it is me.
Okay.
Thanks, Mrs. Wilson.
So some of the goals for this year around special education is really increasing communication, which is getting the website up and going, continuing work with the CPAC. We'd like to have a full staff of qualified professionals meeting the needs of our students, so getting those vacancies filled. We want to continue our professional learning communities. We're doing some great work. Our teachers are meeting vertically in the programs. Our learning center teachers are meeting. Our special ed staff, our speech and language, our occupational therapists are all meeting, so we want to continue that work. And we really, this year, really focusing on targeting the professional development. So I provided you a list of some of the professional development just that we're doing this fall that, again, has been really targeted. It's identifying, last year I shared with you some of the numbers on our teachers who had training. And so based on that information, I've identified staff that will be attending different conferences, different trainings, really targeting what our needs are. So this is just a list of some of the things we'll be offering. In addition, we're continuing our partnership with the Landmark School, who's providing consultation to the Bridge program. They're working with Parker and with the high school. They're also tomorrow meeting with our principals, Mr. Sprung, with our Parker principal and with our high school administrative team to talk about what to be looking for in the classrooms and what role they can play as administrators. So we are also trying to help our principals understand those principles.
Mm-hmm.
Some other important updates, we switched our IEP software, so in the midst of all the changes in software, we also moved to from SEMS Tracker to eSped, so it's been a little bit of a transition, but we're very excited about what eSped has to offer. Transportation-wise, we've been monitoring transportation as there were some trends last year. We have pulled some video just to kind of keep an eye, not that we are seeing any issues, but to have some monitoring. We're still training and remaining in communication with North Reading Transportation. We have a meeting through SEAM Collaborative coming up in October to just talk about some of the trends that we're seeing both in-district transportation and out-of-district transportation. And I think I had reported out about extended school year, but I wanted to reiterate that this past year we had a great extended school year experience. We had a few minor issues that we're trying to resolve more at the middle and high school level, but overall the feedback at the elementary level has been very positive about the work that was done. And I want to acknowledge Kelly Decato, who really coordinated that. So I think that is it for me.
Thank you so much. I did hear that about the extended summer that, yeah. that made its way. Dr. Doxer had a question.
I actually have a couple. I'm going back a little bit.
Sure.
One of the questions that I've been asked on occasion is about the difference between internal. I'm going back to the evaluation page on page 3.
Yeah.
The difference between the internal and external evaluations mm-hmm. that are sometimes hired by parents.
Mm-hmm.
And I know there are legal implications on that. Do you mind talking just
Sure. So
explain.
I can talk a little bit about it. So as a district, if we receive a referral from a parent that they feel they suspect their child has a disability, we have an obligation to complete a full evaluation in all areas of suspected disability. So depending on what that concern is, we might do a speech evaluation, we might do occupational therapy, we might do psychological. It really depends on what the concerns are. Parents have always have a right to go out and get their own evaluation at their own cost. And they can choose to share that with us as a district. If they share it with us and their child is on an IEP, our obligation is to consider that evaluation within 10 school days. So the team needs to come together and consider it. That's if they're on an IEP. If the student is not on an IEP, that information, if a parent chooses to share, because if they pay for it at their own expense, it's their choice. If they choose to share, that's part of our child find obligation, so then it would trigger for us the need to do our own evaluations. The regulations are really clear that we need to look at students from a school-based lens. And so we're charged with completing our own evaluations. We can't duplicate because we would invalidate anything that was done outside, but we might do things that supplement, or if we see in an outside evaluation an area of concern, we might do a different test that looks at that same area. And then the other piece of that is if a parent disagrees with our evaluations, they don't think our evaluations were sufficient, they have a right to request an independent evaluation at public expense. So there's a lot related to evaluations.
Thank you.
Mr. Robinson?
You had another question.
I do have another question. Okay. The other question was on page 7.
Yeah.
Sorry, I couldn't get
yeah.
it in before. You talked about the RISE preschool and you
yeah.
talked about the waiting list. I just wanted to check in because I know there's a percentage of that's mandated
mm-hmm.
for the typical
mm-hmm.
and the special ed students, and even though we have a waiting list, we're within that
yes.
percentage.
Yep. Yep. We work to keep Debbie Butts does a really nice job at managing those numbers. We're full in terms of typical students currently. We always keep space because, as you can imagine, our numbers fluctuate as the year goes on because students turn 3 whenever they turn 3. So we have to be ready.
What is that wait list looking like? Do you know?
Based on my conversation with Debbie last week, at this point, because families are looking for something, she doesn't have anyone waiting currently.
Okay.
Because at this point, people would want their child in a preschool.
They were on the wait list
they
a few months ago, and now they've, yeah,
right.
it's
so
they're
spring.
Not on the wait list
right.
for next year. Yeah, yeah.
Right, so generally, it's in,
spring
the, so in January, we start that enrollment process, but I'm happy to, I can share that once we get our information, probably in January or February.
Yeah. yeah.
I can report that out and share with you the number of applicants we receive and again, it gets challenging because we're always looking at our students with disabilities and they kind of drive the spots.
Yep. Yeah. But it's a very in-demand program.
Yes,
no doubt.
It is.
I did have one more question.
Sure.
The other question was about the special education teacher of reading.
Yes.
Of reading that you've talked about at length. Mm-hmm. One of the things you had mentioned before, and I don't think it was at this meeting, was that the structuring of that position was changed in order to attract.
Yes.
More, can you just say a little
sure.
bit about what that difference?
Yes, so when I started, the position was a 0.6 position, and we really struggled to fill that. So then we made it a full-time position in order to try to attract candidates who might want to work full-time versus a 0.6. We thought that might change, and unfortunately it hasn't. We have a lot of applicants who may have been trained in Wilson or Wharton-Gillingham but don't have the certification. And we're really looking for a different level of credential.
Anybody else from the committee? Anything else? Was there anything? Thank you very much for that update. Mrs. Webb, would you like to lead us? Are you prepared?
Yeah. I am. I'm just sort of wondering, as Carolyn just did, if it might be better for me to go up there so that
yeah.
I can sort of...
Absolutely. While you move, I'll explain the process. Several months ago, the school committee went through our annual process of evaluating Dr. Doherty. It's very much a state-regulated process. We use this state document to evaluate the superintendent of schools. Each of the 6 elected school committee members complete the evaluation independently, and those are all published on the website. They're public documents. Every year we appoint one person from the committee to take all 6 individual evaluations and combine them into one ultimate evaluation, which becomes the official school committee evaluation, and it's no small task. So Mrs. Webb has done it for the 2nd year in a row. Thank you. I know it's an enormous number of hours. So
it's actually like my 5th year or 6th year.
Ah, only 2 that I remember.
Did it for Superintendent Scatini.
This has got a little bit more complicated.
It is.
Since
it's much
then.
More complicated. So let me just say that a couple things. Not many people get to have their performance review in public, but it is something that if you're a superintendent of schools, you do get. and the process, as Jean said, really we laid this process out. And even when we laid this process out, we were sort of a little late with our timeline because we started in late June and we're supposed to finish in late August, when in reality we are supposed to finish really at the beginning of July. So I know that as a committee, we want to be able to put an effort into pulling this in next year. And as Jean said, I've done it for a few years, but it is the chair's responsibility or their designee. So you know, hopefully we can really do that. Because Dr. Doherty completed all his reviews of his people on July for July 1st. So overall, what I decided to do, and the whole thing is online, I want to read through some of the summary comments, and as I do that, we'll get a overview of the various aspects of the report. But so the evaluation was completed by all 6 members of the committee. Beginning on June 27th and completing with the presentation given tonight on September 26th. The school committee definitely appreciates Dr. Doherty's patience, and the process, well, an important aspect of the process that the public understands this is that Dr. Doherty basically does a self-evaluation and provides sort of data and evidence around the goals and the accomplishment and the progress, and then each of the committee members basically takes that can look at that, but uses this 38 criteria evaluation matrix provided by the state. And then in that process, each of us meet with Dr. Doherty to review our evaluations individually, and at least once, if not twice, mm-hmm. in that process, we go through that, and then I basically pull all that information together. So this year, Dr. Doherty receives a commendable overall rating of proficient, which is a very high standard from a school committee and a school community with extremely high expectations. Of the 6 overall individual ratings, I might add, so last year, Julie was fairly new to the committee and she sort of did like an audit, so there was
yes.
only 5.
Right.
So this was actually her first year of actually doing this whole thing. So there were 6 overall individual ratings. 2 were exemplary and 4 were proficient. Members evaluate and rate the superintendent on 38 individual items, and compared to last year's performance, there were more ratings of exemplary and exceed and fewer ratings of needs improvement. So there's an overall rating category, and I want to read some statements from that that really come from all of us. And then for the specific areas, I'm just going to quickly read one or two. They're sort of in an order, but not necessarily. It depended. So they may seem a little out of order to you in terms of topics, but working under intensively challenging conditions, Dr. Daugherty has led our district well this past year. Unfunded and underfunded state and federal mandates combined with expenses outside of his control that are rising faster than our revenues have put our district in position of having to cut programs and staff. Dr. Daugherty has managed to propose budgets which, while less than ideal, put student first. His commitment to minimizing negative impacts to students is commendable. Dr. Daugherty is a recognized leader at the state level when it comes to social emotional learning. This was written before the invitations to Washington, so then that would say federal level. His passion and expertise have positioned Reading to be a leader in this area. His willingness to take on the challenge of looking at changing school start times and his goal of implementing multi-tiered system of supports for both academics and social emotional learning is to be commended. Given our limited resources, we need to do a better job of prioritizing Dr. Daugherty's goal. While I'm impressed with the progress we've made in the development of PLCs and MTSS, I'm concerned about the lack of progress in areas of curriculum and instruction and assessment and would like to see faster progress in these areas and pacing guides in math and ELA. Relatedly, I'm deeply concerned about staff attrition. While it's incumbent upon us to maintain competitive salary levels relative to peer communities, it is also incumbent upon us to recognize our limited resources and not expect more than we have capacity for. So this is something we'll be talking about, I'm sure, as the year goes on this year. Dr. Daugherty's work ethic is unparalleled. He leads by example. The Reading Public Schools are lucky to have a dedicated, experienced, committed educator as their superintendent. Superintendent Daugherty understands learning and instruction and can organize and manage a district while engaging, supporting, and inspiring his team of administrators despite unexpected challenges and an overabundance of responsibilities. He's an administrator who recognizes the importance of opportunities for growth and leadership for staff and students, as well as the importance of education and collaboration with families. Through dedication, commitment, time, and knowledge, he has grappled with unexpected absences of staff due to a spectrum of health reasons, tragic loss of teachers. We had some very tragic losses last year, and Dr. Daugherty's leadership in bringing the staff and the students and the families through that is really commendable. He worked closely with the Director of Pupil Services to improve services and reconfigure to the recommendations of the Walker Report while trying to compensate for staffing challenges. He has invited, analyzed, and reported on feedback from teachers as well as students, parents, and administrators. He answers outreach personally when appropriate and refers questions to his leadership when appropriate in order not to detract from their authority. He protects his staff and leadership from miscellaneous agendas that might overload their already overflowing plates, and he works to make the working agenda the result of a collaborative effort. He is at work more than he is at home, and he still makes time to chaperone at school events such as high school sports, robotics tournaments, and many, many other district events. Dr. Daugherty recognizes the intense work demands and funding limitations on salaries complicates this further, which is why he has been advocating for increased funding on both the local and state level relative to sort of Chapter 70 formulas. Despite all the efforts to involve the leadership and staff in decision-making, when hard decisions have to be made, he makes them. When outcomes do not match goal, he takes personal responsibility. The buck stops at Dr. Daugherty, and he embraces that responsibility with knowledge and professionalism. Dr. Daugherty's approach to the budget process is thorough, beyond reproach, transparent, fiscally responsible, and backs up every decision with the impact on students. He assures that the evaluation and presentation of data considers all audiences. This year, he honed in on per pupil expenditures, slicing it in a multiplicity of ways to ensure valid interpretation and effective conveyance of meaning. He fully supports the innumerable number of meetings with school committee, budget parents, school communities, financial committee, financial forum, and town meeting. So those were an excerpt of the comments from the overall section. And I might add that as part of this process, school committee members are required to provide a statement of a rationale statement for any rating that is not proficient. So any rating that is above proficient or below proficient is required to have a rationale. So that's basically what I pulled that together, but instead of rewording everything, these are our individual actual comments. And again, those were from the overall section. So I just want to read a couple from the specific standards. So under instructional leadership, according to our state senator, Jason Lewis, it is significantly due to the efforts of our superintendent, John Daugherty, and our social emotional learning director, Sarah Bird, that there is a safe and supportive schools movement gaining credibility and support across the state. That in turn supports our teachers and enables our progressive implementation through affirmation and through grant resources. I was cutting down on some. So, while all five of Dr. Daugherty's goals are important, student learning must be paramount. Dr. Daugherty has led the district in making significant progress in the area of building staff capacity through professional learning communities and the implementation of social-emotional behavior supports for students. But we have not seen as much progress in the area of curriculum instruction assessment. With the statewide assessment in flux and the Mass DESE transitions from MCAS to Parks, the newly promised MCAS 2.0, we have particular obligation to make progress in this area. The teacher-led effort to pilot, evaluate, and begin a three-year implementation of the new science curricula that reflects the new Massachusetts State Science Standards was a significant accomplishment this year. The phased approach of implementing the new science standards over a three-year period is judicious and well-planned. Teacher, student, and parent feedback on the No Adam science curriculum has been overwhelmingly positive, and the superintendent is to be commended for implementing a comprehensive one-year pilot to gather information from all stakeholders. Again, there were many more comments in each of these sections. The second standard is management and operations. Dr. Daugherty works under difficult budget constraints but continues to maintain excellent management and operations. He functions very well with human resources and legal, and he's always on top of maintaining a safe and secure learning environment for our students and staff. The cost-neutral implementation of the new student management system and website promises to be an impressive accomplishment given our district's financial constraints. We have seen strong collaboration between municipal and school departments this year. At the suggestion of our auditors, our director of finance worked with our town accountant to assure that the use of school revolving funds is appropriate. The result was increased trust and transparency. The successful reorganization of the facilities department and an agreement to share a human resources position are other examples of solid collaboration between municipal and school departments, and I hope to see the spirit of collaboration and partnership grow next year. Dr. Daugherty is a creative problem solver. When our budget was cut, he found ways to restructure, enabling us to avoid cuts that would hurt students. Unfortunately, these cuts hurt the morale of the already devoted staff. Knowing this, Dr. Daugherty has been advocating for more funding to avoid future cuts. Family and community engagement. Over the past 2 years, Dr. Daugherty has gone above and beyond with respect to engaging the community to solicit their opinions with regard to the educational experiences that exist or should exist. This approach has been greatly appreciated by the community and appears to have prompted similar efforts by other governmental boards. The superintendent has been working hard to ensure prompt, transparent, and informative communication with families and the community. He faithfully publishes both the Journey and the Pathways blog, ensuring timely communications, whether it is Sunday weekly newsletters or interim updates on school happenings. He has led the charge amongst his staff, incorporating social media to get the word out. And now most of the school administrators have blogs, Facebook pages, and maintain their Redica pages. but Edline then. Some even use Twitter. This is challenging when his and his administration plates are already full and overflowing. More. Dr. Daugherty's willingness to engage with parents and residents is impressive. His community forums in the spring of 2015 formed the basis for his budget recommendations. His attendance at school events during the evening and weekends is also commendable. Dr. Daugherty's thorough and timely communication of the issues surrounding higher than acceptable lead levels in the water in some of our schools was held up by the Mass Water Resources Authority as a model of how communication could be handled. And I just want to add that that was done under some incredible time constraints so thoroughly, and just really, you know, proud of how, and actually since this was written, there's been more really good, solid work on that. The increasing use of social and other online media by Dr. Darty and principals is a positive development. And I think we have one more category, the standard four, which is for professional culture. Dr. Darty's work to lead the district in staff development and capacity building is another area of strengths, highlighting the PLCs and building base meetings. Dr. Darty will stand behind the educated decision of the administrator and teachers who advocate for the curriculum. He empowers teachers to make educated decisions through pilot testing and respects each administrator's ability to make the best decision for their school or department. Decisions are not made in a vacuum. The superintendent orchestrates a tightly and collaboratively planned leadership council, which maintains communication and hones curriculum and practices the Reading Public Schools' mission and desired outcomes. The framework, language, and follow-through from these meetings are intentionally shared with teacher leaders and expectations for the PLCs. I am concerned about a staff morale problem that was documented in the community and staff forum feedback presentations and anecdotally mentioned. I wonder if that partially derives from the demand put on our staff to perform to their highest ability, even though unfunded state mandates continue, paperwork has multiplied, student needs have escalated, and the school budget limits their compensation despite the pressure to put in longer hours. And I think this is the last. Oh, one more. Dr. Darty inspires his administration to work above and beyond, even when challenges compound and seem to overwhelm. He has led and supported our administration through staff deaths, resignations, disciplinary processes, budget challenge, staff layoffs, shelter in place. I see his role modeling and support reflected in the commitment and dedication of his administrators. And Dr. Darty, my last comment. Dr. Darty has extremely high standards and a shared vision for the entire district. He truly wants all students to have the benefit of the best education possible, and fosters an environment of excellence for his entire staff. So again, I believe this is online as well as all of our individual ones, and we're very pleased to have worked the process on behalf of the committee, and was proud to present the review to Dr. Darty.
Thank you, Mrs. Wynn.
I'd just like to thank Elaine for the job she did. I like the approach she took to Elaine. As opposed to try to summarizing everything and pulling it together, which I think, I thought of it as quite a challenge. No, I'm not going to do that. But nice job.
Anything else?
I'm glad to be finally done.
I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Darty for yet another year of service. A lot of it came out in the instrument, but I found myself thinking that if we want our administrators and our teachers to be reflective practitioners and to work above and beyond, which we know they have to do in Reading, you very much modeled that, and I appreciate that, particularly for somebody with your decades of experience and your resume. You are very reflective, and particularly to other areas of note, the time that you spend with kids in the district, a district as large as ours, with as strong an administrative team as we have, it would be reasonable for a superintendent to say, well, the principals and teachers take care of that, and you're constantly chaperoning events and on playgrounds and with kids, and I think that keeps you very connected to the work. So I appreciate that commitment. And I'm really glad that the communication came out in several of the evaluations, because that was a strength this year, particularly on the LED. But even this evening, there was some state information that has high value to the community, and it came out, and there was an email, and that just right away. So that's, I know that is not easy to pull off, but it's very appreciated. So, thank you. Anything else on this?
I just wanted to say also that in the speeches that you've done, both at the openings for the school year, at graduation, in the baccalaureate, it's extremely evident how tuned in you are to not only the student body as a whole, but also to the needs of individual students and the ways that the teachers have addressed those needs creatively. And I think every time I hear those speeches, I'm inspired. and I, the successes that it was mentioned by UD that don't just stop at the high school, they go on ad infinitum, I think that that's quite a legacy, and I think we're very lucky to have such a dedicated superintendent. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there a motion?
Move to approve the superintendent's end of cycle summative evaluation report for the 2015-16 school year.
Good. Any other discussion?
Can I just make a brief comment before you vote?
I'm glad, yes.
So this past year was a very busy and challenging year. I mean, Elaine mentioned we had two teachers pass. We had two other retired teachers pass. And so that was challenging in itself, going through that. We had budget challenges, we had curriculum challenges, instructional challenges, staffing challenges, but we had a lot of good things happen too. And I think the only reason why those things happen is that you have a strong team that you're working with. You mentioned the email that went out tonight, and I'm gonna say this in my report too, but that email was because we received the results on Friday. They were embargoed until 4:30 today. You know, a member of my team, Craig, spent the entire weekend going over those results so that we could have that timely communication. Carolyn gave you a report of the work that she's doing. You know, there's a lot of people working very hard in this district. So I appreciate the feedback. Certainly my goal is always to do better. But the reason, the good things that you're hearing is because of the team that we have in place. The principals, central office administrators, other administrators, it's really been, and they're all working hard. I don't have to tell you that.
No.
So, you know, my thanks goes out to them.
Well, I think that's a really good point, and I'm glad that you made it. But I will end by saying that the captain of the team deserves a tremendous amount of credit as well.
Yeah.
So we'll end with that. Yeah, honestly, great. Did we take a vote on that?
Not yet.
We shall have we? A second.
Yeah.
Yeah, great. All those in favor? Okay, 6-0. I think we're going to move on to a discussion of the Board of Selectmen's ballot question. When last we met, the Board of Selectmen had just approved putting a question on the ballot on October 18th for voters in Reading to decide on a $7.5 million override. And it will roughly be split two-thirds, one-third to the schools in town, the historic revenue split that we've had. We as a committee voted on priorities. There's just shy of $1 million, $960,000, that should the override pass, would be available to the school budget that isn't currently available. So the majority of the money is to solve the structural deficit. I feel like we have addressed that well enough. But there would be just shy of $1 million, and we as a committee voted based on Dr. Doherty's recommendation on a list of priorities of necessary, I really consider them foundational supports that are gonna improve student achievement in the district. So we have the option as a committee of taking a position on this ballot question, and it is an option. There's no reason we have to or have not to. But I wanted to throw it out to the committee to see if there was an appetite to take a vote and to take a position, not as individuals, which we all can do if we choose, but as a committee. So that was my opening comment for discussion this evening. Mrs. Webb.
I want to thank you for bringing this to the committee, and I do feel like it's very important for us to address this. And, you know, although our initial list was more than $2.96 million, and the selectmen, you know, had a very difficult decision to make, and the override amount of $7.5 million is the override that's before the community. And I know I have heard that some people are, you know, dissatisfied because it wasn't the full amount that we had requested and felt should be put before the community for the schools. I think it's essential that we show leadership on support of this and, you know, what the selectmen have put on the ballot, because it is what is on the ballot. It is what if the community does support it, what will be available to us for the FY, beginning in the FY 18 budget. And I think addressing the structural deficit and these needs is critical. And so I very much support us discussing this, and I support, you know, voting in to showing a vote of support, and I would definitely do that.
I'm very comfortable supporting this. I have been since the beginning, and you know, frankly, this was a number I felt initially that back when we discussed this about a month ago, I guess. So.
I'm kind of in, follow along the same lines of Chuck. This is a number that I'm comfortable with, that I can get behind. I've attended a lot of different meetings. We've talked about this for months now, and here in town meeting, and this, I fully appreciate there are lots of different opinions in the community, and there are lots of different circumstances, and I fully support whatever anyone decides to do on this. But from my point of view, as a member of the school committee, this is necessary, and it I don't want my taxes increased. But in the same token, I do want what's best for our children, and I think this is an excellent representation of how to move the district forward.
Thank you.
I very much agree with what has been said previous to this, and I too am happy with the fact that the Board of Selectmen were able to determine an amount that is sustainable. That was my biggest concern, and I'm glad to see that has arisen.
I also wanted to say, as a school committee member and a citizen and as a town meeting member, that I support this fully. I think that it's taken us a long time to get here, and we've known it's coming. As hard as it is, I think that this override is a true reflection of the collaboration between the different departments in the town. The schools, the town, the library, all the different departments have come together, and the compromise on the amount that's being asked of the citizens to vote for it is a reflection of that. And I think that as much as I wanted my cake and to eat it too, I think that the collaboration really said this is the best way for us to approach this. And I think that it would be incredibly problematic not to pass this override, because the cuts that we'll see will take us a very long time to fix if we have to make those cuts. And so I am fully in support of this override and truly hope others will join us.
If I could just add one other comment in between the time. Well, we've had a town meeting in between the time that we first voted, and then the selectmen put the $7.5 million forward. And one of the really important outcomes, I think, of that town meeting, and it was one of the reasons that this process sort of took a long time, is that the Board of Selectmen were working on some tax policy related to seniors. And I just want to say that I think it's very important that the community has a diverse base of people who use mostly municipal services, maybe people who use school services, but you have to have a mix. And so I think one of the things that was really important for me in terms of, you know, not, I'm sure we could be seen, or I personally might be seen as just a person who wants to, is maybe not cautious enough about raising taxes. I want to say that the senior tax relief, the support that basically the programs that the selectmen put forward and then town meeting decided to support, I think are really essential for trying to do whatever we can to make for those folks who, you know, this is difficult for, perhaps a little bit easier. So I'm really pleased that was something that transpired in this time frame, and it just helps to be, you know, in a position of support to know that those are also there.
Those are all great points.
I guess I also just wanted to make the point that there is, and I know you'll say this again, but that there is some confusion about the votes that are coming up.
We'll bring that up right now.
Yeah, okay. Let's stick to the motion.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. You know,
well, it sounds like there's real consensus, so that's a good thing. But I would agree with a lot that has been said. When I think about what Dr. Nine said about the sustainability piece and how the selectmen and the town manager worked so hard to come up with a way that, how can we solve the problem we have in July but have it sustainable for 8 to 10 years? And communicate that to the community so that they can have that confidence. And you're absolutely right, Mrs. Webb. I mean, thinking about the senior population, we know there's a group that's vulnerable in town, and how do we protect them? I would be curious to know if there's any community that has put as much effort and time into a proposal for an override, because it's an enormous amount of effort and thoughtfulness that went into this. I think at this point I'll take a motion. Yeah, go right ahead.
Move to support the Board of Selectmen's ballot question of a $7.5 million override.
Second.
Everyone else said their piece, so I didn't. I'll say mine. I'm also in support of this override, and my reason really is this has evolved over the last 6 to 9 months, longer really, but really intensely over the last 6 to 9 months when we've really spent a lot of time as a community on it. It's clear now that there's two paths forward for our community, and a no vote means we are cutting an enormous number of staff. We're eating into the foundation of our district, and I absolutely believe a no vote will have a negative impact on student achievement. And to your point, Mrs. Joyce, I have no interest in raising my taxes or anybody else's, but I was elected to protect the schools, and when I look at that outcome and I know that this is going to negatively impact students, I have to support this, at least tell the community that a no vote will have very damaging impact on the schools. A yes vote, because of what Mr. Nyan said, is so sustainable. It doesn't just solve the problem for next year. It creates a financially stable future for almost a decade, or up to a decade. When I look at these positions that we know we need, you know, Dr. Doherty, in your evaluation, we talked about we want more supervision of the curriculum. You have Craig. We know that we need actual human beings to do that work because our teachers are actually teaching. I think when I look at some of the challenges we clearly have as a district, we're trying to address these, and I think the money would be well spent. So I'm also in support.
If I could just add one piece that came up at town meeting, but I don't think has gotten out there enough, and I know it's come up as questions. During the life of the override, $5 million of the $7.5 million will be dedicated to the school department budget, $2.5 million to the town budget. And the town manager didn't make that point at town meeting, because a lot of questions have been asked. Well, the schools are only getting $960,000, which we know isn't okay. So that is a piece of information that has kind of been out there, but hasn't, I don't think, been emphasized.
Yeah. Yep, it's a good point. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, any other comments on this? All those in favor of the motion? It's 6-0. Thank you.
I just wanted to finish my statement of before. Confusion.
I'm so sorry.
That's all right. The confusion that I was talking about was the date of the election.
Oh,
that
okay.
It's October 18th.
Oh, okay.
And not happening at the November election.
This is a
I just
local
wanted to clarify
election.
That the local election is at a separate
time. October 18th. Thank you, Dr. That's a very important point. Anything else on that? I think it's time for reports. we had our student reports already. So, committee, anybody on the committee? Yeah, Mrs. Webb.
So the RACASA, we probably have had a RACASA meeting in between, but the most importantly, the RACASA annual meeting is this week on Thursday in the Performing Arts Center at 7:00. And there's a really, in addition to really Erica, who's our director, does an amazing job of sort of presenting that annual summary. And there's just obviously there's been a lot of news about issues with the opioid issue. There's a really important film screening called Breaking Points, and it links the really the issues with prescription drug use or abuse. Prescription drug abuse as an area where our youth is very vulnerable, and how youth can really become sort of engaged in that drug culture through that. And the film, I think, is going to be shown Thursday night, and then there'll be at least one other opportunity. I don't know if John has that, but there'll be another opportunity to see it.
It's in November. I can't remember the date, but it is in November.
which will probably be at the Performing Arts Center as well. So I highly recommend that people make an effort to get to either the annual meeting in this week or in November. And also, RACASA coming up has the young adolescents bedroom, which will be set up at the police station, which is called In Plain Sight. And that is October 17th, 18th.
I think so.
So that's coming up. So I would ask people to just go on the RACASA webpage, which is accessible from the school webpage, and just keep your eyes on the papers and other announcements. But again, that's going to be a really enlightening display for parents to basically see the everyday items that you might look at, you know, pick up, move while you're making some kid's bed that you shouldn't be making, but, you know, and not even realize that that should be a signal to you to look for other things. So I think that's a really important thing. I urge people to participate. Thank you.
Anyone else on the committee? Dr. Dawson.
So I have a couple of reports to make. One was on the CPAC that met, I don't know, time flies like these clocks. Is it 2 weeks ago, Alicia? 2 weeks ago, there was a very animated Q&A session and presentation by Carolyn Wilson. And I was very impressed, and I said it then, by the knowledge of the parents, by the honesty and transparency about, as we heard tonight, about the challenges as well as the good things that are going on in the district with the special ed programs. And many thanks to Alicia Williams for leading the CPAC. And the other team of parents that are leading this group to get information and resources out there. I encourage people to come to these meetings. It's a great way to connect to the parents and to hear straight from the director about questions they have, and to find out if the director's, as we heard tonight, if the director's not the right person to ask, then who is? So I think I learned a ton at that meeting, and I really appreciated the way it was run and the presentation that was made. And the date of the next meeting is?
October
6th.
Yeah, can I just add something really quick? That you said something about transparency, and I want to just tell the school committee that I got a phone call from a parent from out of district who she doesn't even live in town, was looking at different towns to move into, and was told that our director of student services was so transparent, so fantastic. We are so lucky to have her. So I don't know if I told you that, but it was something I just want to make sure you guys heard. It was really nice to hear. I mean, she went on and gushed about Carolyn, so.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
I'd
like to second that.
Oh, you were going to say that? I'm sorry.
No, I wasn't, but I said I'd second what you said. That's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, Alicia.
So the next report is for the Human Relations Advisory Committee. We're still working on the Martin Luther King Day celebration. We have some new our student liaisons, their energy and their passion is just inspiring, and they're right now firming up a program that they're hoping to pitch, and they brought a teacher in who's been really instrumental in helping them hone in on what they'd like to do in conjunction with our program and the theme for the year. And again, it's going to be a light breakfast, and January 16th, please put it in your calendars. And if you're interested in getting involved or showcasing your local philanthropic organization, please call or email me or Heather McLean, who is the chair of this committee. The next meeting is October 6th at 7 at the police station in the community room. And separate from that, we held the METCO pool party, and at that pool party was launched the Friends of METCO program again. So if you are interested in getting involved with that program, please contact Jason Cross. It's going to be a way for students from Reading, from wherever they live, whether it's Boston or Reading, to work together, get to know each other and support each other, and enable children to be able to attend extracurricular activities and have support in town. And thank you for the people who donated food and services for that event. And thank you to Coach Margison, who again did the lifeguarding at the pool party. And the last thing I was going to say, oh, two things. The next to last thing I was going to say was just from personal experience in the Spanish exchange program that was here. Our Spanish friends left last week, and from what I heard, a good time was made had by all that the students didn't want to see their friends leave, but they're looking forward to going to visit them. I personally could have had Angela live with us for another month. She was wonderful, and they were able to visit some classrooms. The teachers were able to visit some classrooms, and they wanted to make sure that I said thank you to the teachers and principals because they learned a lot, and they couldn't get enough pictures of all the of the libraries and the core value programs that were out there. These were ideas that they're taking back to their schools. The last thing I wanted to say is stay tuned. There's another training coming up for the youth mental health first aid. I believe it's the first weekend in November, but that's why I just took out my phone. I was going to look it up, even though I don't use my phone during these meetings. But stay tuned. I'm signed up for it. I hope other people will sign up for it. I hear it's really worthwhile. I know the adult first aid was, mental health first aid course was very worthwhile. Thank you.
Anything else from the committee? Dr. Knight.
Very quick. We won't be meeting until this is already concluded, but October 15th is Sally Musica Walkathon. Sally Musica was a teacher that retired, highly regarded, highly esteemed, and she passed away, unfortunately, year ago, last July. This is an event that will pay, you know, help support a scholarship that I was amazed at how much last year. I think we raised $8,000, which is pretty impressive for the first time around. Just speaks to the reverence people had for Sally Musica. So that's going to be held again this October 15th, 10 o'clock. It starts at Wood End Elementary School, and you can go online to register. It's smilesforsally.org, and it was a worthwhile cause.
Thanks, Dr. Nye. What a legacy for an educator to leave.
Yeah,
have that
yeah.
kind of reverence, as you said. A brief report for the committee. I've taken a couple questions from the community about whether or not our committee, the School Committee of Reading, would take a position on ballot question 2. That's a question that will be on the statewide during the presidential election in November. And it's about expanding charter schools in the Commonwealth. And so what I've advised individuals who've asked, but I wanted to take the opportunity to say it publicly, is that at the moment, our town is at a crossroads. And on October 18th, we as a community are going to be making a vote that is going to have a long-term and a profound impact on the education of the 4,400 or so students who attend Reading Public Schools. So at this point, our committee is going to focus on that ballot question. So that is the answer for right now. We will focus on this because the impact to our students is just so important. So right now, that's where our focus is going to be. That's it for me. Dr. Doherty, turn it over to you for...
Actually, did you want to...
Yeah, I mean, just echo that, as was stated a couple times, that the state did release their assessment and accountability data today. As Dr. Doherty said, we received the information on Friday. So feel it's very important to get the information out to the entire community as quickly as possible. In the first few days, really what we're able to do is just sort of an initial review. We tried to highlight a few things that were most immediately apparent even before we do a deeper dive into everything. Some areas that look really strong, some areas maybe that we're not happy with, some areas where we're seeing some definite progress being made. One of the first steps, and you know, we realize maybe not everybody wants to look through all of the data, but we put together tables of information because that's not how we get the information. I mean, it's in pages and pages of different things, different schools, different subject areas, every different grade. I feel it's sort of helpful because it's so easy to get caught up in one particular area to get sort of this at a glance systemic view. And so that's what the tables are trying to represent, that we, it's helpful for us. We feel we might as well be very transparent and show the community what we're looking at. It kind of shows our entire district, not only this year, but in relation to all the grade levels at all the different schools, compared to last year, the year before, and so forth, to try to look at context. Over the next few weeks, we'll be looking at all those areas much more deeply. And as we said in the announcement that went out too, the state has indicated to us that we'll probably be receiving the individual student information for parents in the next week or so, and so hopefully within a couple weeks, those things will be being sent home. So if there are parents watching that are interested in how their own child did, that will be coming very shortly also.
That's earlier than last year, isn't
it?
It's much earlier.
Yeah, that was like November or something.
Right.
Yeah.
That's good.
Do those come, and we have to mail them? I know.
We choose, yes, they'll get shipped here, UPS,
yeah.
Boxes.
Boxes, and then we have to put them in envelopes and mail
yeah.
them?
Yeah, we've had to do that for years.
Oh my,
we feel it's better to mail them rather than.
Oh, it definitely would not be good to give them to the kids,
yeah.
But I always assumed it came from the state.
No.
Oh my goodness, how about just the.
I'm going to ask a question about that. Does the state provide us the manpower to mail all those things?
No.
Nope. So that
oh
would be
my
what we call an unfunded mandate.
Word.
But the postage?
No.
No.
They would tell you that that's what our Chapter 70 funding is for, things like that.
Didn't Jason Lewis spend all this time evaluating that, the Chapter 70 funding?
There was a committee that looked at it, yeah.
There was a commission.
Yep.
Mrs. Joyce. Thank you for getting all of that information out so quickly, and I know people have already jumped on it and are reading everything that you've sent out. So I'm just wondering, and I know that I read through it too, the plan will be to have informational meetings at individual schools.
Yeah, I should have said, I did say that in the announcement that went out, that sometime next month, I know we're scheduled to give an overview to the committee here, but every school will be doing their own individual presentation as well for their school community to really take an individual look at their own school's strengths, areas for improvement, and so forth, progress that they have made or still need to make, and go into it in more depth at each individual school.
So those will probably, they'll take place in October, and I think we're like on October 25th or something.
Yeah, they'll,
typically
those meetings will be done before the school committee presentation.
I'd just like to say I was impressed to see Reading Memorial High School go from a 2-1.
Yeah.
I think that's indicative of, you know, of staff really working collaboratively under some very strong leadership of Adam Barker and his administrative team. So that's you know, very prestigious to be a 1, as we all know. So I was pretty very impressed.
Yeah, well, and see some of the results, too, that we highlighted there at the and again, I think it's important that we're able to see the whole vertical arrangement of where, you know, ultimately things are ending up well, but we've got some areas that we're still addressing throughout. Because again, it's so easy, especially when we don't have some of the other administrative support, to get so caught up just within one's own school. I think we talked about that a couple of years ago, how important it is to always be aware of what's happening at the other schools and how we're able to collaborate and all of that. So that's been a real big focus, is to make sure that we're seeing it in a bigger picture, not just in isolation.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Martin, and for spending your entire weekend looking at Excel spreadsheets. But it was a good memo and phenomenal news about the high school, no doubt.
I just was going to highlight, I had what you just said about, I can't believe you got this data. The state thinks that it's okay to give the districts the data on a Friday and then release the embargo to send it to the communities and the parents
on Monday,
without giving you a single full work day to evaluate the data. Nobody would do that in corporate industry. I just think that you wouldn't take sensitive data like that, right, and not give your CEO and your directors and your VPs the time to at least put some context around it. I'm shocked. I did actually get to look at this when I was on my lunch hour today, and I thought, wow, but
yeah,
you did it in no time. So thank you so much.
Yeah. And I'm really looking forward to your longer presentation and having a more robust discussion as a committee,
yeah,
about the results.
Okay.
I have a few things. First, I wanted to pass out this draft calendar, which now will be included from this point forward in your packet. If you remember last year, we did a little bit different. Instead of having individual school presentations, We made a shift last year to focus more on topic areas that are relevant to the goals, the focus areas that as a district we're working on. So you will see that again captured. Now, this is a very fluid calendar, and as you know, it may change. The topics may change. If something is more time sensitive, that may get bumped up, or things are certainly going to be added. But right now, this is where we are. So the next time we meet, as you can see, so October, there'll be a policy reading on the student activity account. So that's one thing that came out of the audit, if you remember, in spring. We'll start doing curriculum updates after the MCAS presentation on the 24th. So we're doing one on literacy. We'll be doing one on math in December, one in social emotional learning. With the grant update, there'll be a high school initiative piece, which you'll get a report on the late start on the 22nd of November. January is budget discussions. We'll be doing a district goal update on the 6th. And you can see there's other topics that we're going to be presenting to the committee, library, media, and technology, communication. Carolyn will do another special education update. You'll see district goal updates. This is in preparation for the superintendent's evaluation, which I put down May 22nd.
I see that.
We'll get turned around October.
So again, this is a starting point, but you can see these are the types of topics we'll be presenting to you throughout the year.
Thank you, Dr. Doherty, for putting this together. And this is probably a good time to remind the committee that this is our agenda. And so if you are reading through it and you are thinking, boy, I really, you know, I don't see this on the agenda, and I'm the person to contact. So certainly copy Dr. Doherty so he knows what's going on. But this is, as Dr. Doherty said, very fluid. So please take a look at it and get feedback to me and to him as well.
Okay. A couple other things. On at our next meeting, I do want to do a presentation, nothing in-depth, but a little bit more detail about our trip to Washington, D.C. But just briefly, first of all, we were absolutely thrilled and honored to be invited to attend this conference. We found out about it about 2 weeks before. The state was invited, and they specifically asked that Reading be invited. The state chose not to attend. So we asked, well, can we still attend? Which the federal government said, yes, absolutely, you can. We found all this out about 2 weeks prior to the departure. So the conference, which was at the White House, featured with the topic of the conference was trauma-informed approaches in school, supporting girls of color and rethinking discipline. So when you first look at the title, you think, you know, what does this have to do with Reading Public Schools? But the supporting girls of color is the overall theme, because that's where the data is showing high levels of discipline, disproportionate levels of discipline with girls of color. However, the trauma-informed approaches are things that you can apply in every single school district, every single school. We do have students in Reading that have been through a lot of trauma in their lives and come to school every day, and our teachers need to find ways to engage them and educate them. So this conference, clearly we got a lot out of it. Carolyn, myself, Sarah Bird attended. It was sponsored by several organizations, including the Federal Department of Education, the White House Council on Women and Girls, Georgetown Law Center on Poverty and Inequality, et cetera. There were 14 states represented, so we represented the state of Massachusetts. And we heard presentations all day from key researchers and policymakers at the federal level. The Secretary of Education spoke, John King. So now, as a district, we've had the pleasure of hearing two Secretary of Educations in the last few years, Arne Duncan and John King. And we also had an opportunity to share the best practices that we have learned in breakout sessions in the afternoon. And then we reported back out to the large group after that was done. So it was really a very long day. There were very, we laughed, there was no breaks. We were eating on the fly to get to the next breakout session. But we learned a lot from it. We will definitely share more with you at our next presentation. I do want to add that the trip was funded through our school transformation grant, and we did not accept the invitation until we got approval from the grant coordinator in Washington that this would fund it, that the expenses would be funded out of this grant. So this was not out of the operating budget. This was solely out of the grant. So I will definitely go into more detail in a couple of weeks, but I wanted to just, you know, give you a little bit of detail on the trip that we attended. It was definitely worthwhile. And, you know, we were very proud to represent Massachusetts at the conference. And then the only other thing I want to add is last week, Tom Zayer accepted award on behalf of Reading Public Schools from the MIAA. We received an award in gratitude for the way that we host MIAA tournaments here. We host a lot of state tournaments because of our facility, but also because of the quality of the hosting, which is a direct relation to Tom's work and the work of the coaches and other staff that work at those tournaments. So Tom did receive an award last week on that, so I want to make sure that he's in the school is recognized for that. So that's my report.
Can I just add something?
Yeah.
I'm at a lot of tournaments and a lot of sites throughout the course of the year and have been for many years. And I think I mentioned last year that Division II state championship wrestling tournament was here. And I've never seen one run as smoothly as that one. Mm-hmm. I've been doing this for about 40 years.
Wow.
Thanks, John. No, I wouldn't have been doing it when I was five.
Well, it's a well-deserved honor. Are there any other reports tonight? No? I think then we're going to move into executive session again. Yeah.
Move to enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to salary negotiations for non-represented personnel and the approval of minutes and to return to open session at approximately 9:45.
Yes, exactly.
Second.
All those in favor, this is a roll call vote. Mrs. Webb?
Yes.
Dr. Doxson?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, we're in executive session.
profound things, but it was not
and
recorded.
And the world will never know.
Oh.
No, I didn't make him stay. I said you could go home.
That was very nice then.
I think you did have the
debate on.
Big screen.
On a big screen.
Excuse me, Leon.
I got pictures of her. She actually got on TV.
I'm going to call the school committee meeting of September 26, 2016 back to order. Mr. Robinson.
Move to approve the superintendent's salary increase of 2.5%, which is an annual amount of $183,067 for the 2016-17 school year.
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Thank you again, Dr. Doherty. All those in favor? 6-0. Do I hear any other motions?
Yes, you were going to say something.
I was? I don't think so. Is there anyone who's going to move to adjourn?
I'm motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? We are adjourned.